Well, good morning, family.
Good morning.
How's everyone doing today?
Great.
The worship team said great. How's everybody doing out there today?
Great.
Everybody doing good? Good. Good to see you guys this morning. I just want to give you a few announcements before we move in or move on with the service. First of all, just letting you know, the reason I'm doing announcements this morning is because I'm not speaking today. But we have our own Pastor Kennie Berger, who's going to be speaking and continuing our series today. We're excited about that. We're still in the This Is Us series, and Pastor Kennie is going to be doing part three, which is all about family. So he's going to be preaching, teaching on family today. So I'm excited about that. But I have a couple of things I just want to share with you that are coming up in March. The first thing is something called Growth Track. And you may have been here and heard announcements about it the last couple of weeks, but I just want to share with you a little bit about when it's going to be. It's going to be March 8th and March 15th. It's two Sundays. It'll take place at 9:30 in the morning, so from 9:30 until service starts. It'll be right here in the fellowship hall. So if you want to do one of three things, then we ask you to go through Growth Track. The first is if you want to take membership in the church. And if you want to be a member of First AG, we would like you to go through Growth Track and hear a little bit about the church, hear a little bit about where we're headed. If you want to get connected more in the church, maybe you're new to the church. We have a lot of folks that are brand new and you don't know a lot of people in the church yet, and you just want to get connected, then we want you to go through Growth Track to get connected. The third thing is if you want to serve, and of course, we want you to serve on any of the serve teams that are available to be a part of here at the church. And if you want to serve in the church, then we want you to go through Growth Track. So it's just two Sundays. We'll hold it once a quarter. And then move on from there. But after you go through the two Sundays, you have the opportunity to take membership. It doesn't mean that you go through them and you have to take membership. But if you go through them and you are on board with our vision and you want to be a part of the church moving forward, then you have the opportunity to take membership. Now, you don't have to take membership to come and attend and be a part of the family, but we would sure like you to. We would sure love you to. So be thinking about that. The signups for that is in the lobby. And then the last Sunday in March, for those who go through Growth Track, we're going to have a coming into covenant service. It'll be the last Sunday in March. You can come into covenant with First AG and just stand before the church and take membership. And we'll also be doing baptisms that Sunday. So if you or someone in your family or one of your grandkids or kids in Children's Church or youth wants to get baptized that Sunday, the signups for that are in the lobby as well. And then at the end of Growth Track, you'll have the opportunity to sign up for the membership covenant. So either way, we'll have an awesome, awesome service that Sunday. Last thing I want to tell you about is this coming Wednesday night, we're having worship by the fire. So what we normally do is we have teaching right here in the sanctuary, but what we're going to do is we're going to have all of us as a family, that includes kids, youth, babies, everybody, we're going to be down at the youth building. We're going to have a campfire, we're going to have hot dogs, waters, and then we're asking you just to bring a chair to sit in around the fire, and then bring a side or a snack or a dessert if you like to share with your family. So bring that along, be a part. We're going to have a great time of worship. We're going to complete our Ephesians series with a short teaching on Ephesians 6, and then just enjoy each other's company. So I invite you officially to come out Wednesday night to be a part of that. Even if you're not normally here on Wednesday night services, try to make it. Try to come out and be a part and just be a part of the family. Amen? All right. Would you stand with me this morning? We're going to go to the Lord in prayer and then go to worship. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to be here today, Lord. And we give you praise, honor, and glory. Father, this Sunday, this gathering of believers is all about you. We're here today, Lord, to worship you. We're here today, Lord, to recognize how great you are. As we sing, as we preach, as we pray, it's all about you, Lord. Father, we just pray that you would have your way in us, Lord. We know that we are but dust, as the Bible claims, that we are people, Lord, and we make mistakes. But Father, I just pray that you would reach in, that you would give us what we need today, that you would speak to us and let us be forever changed as we leave here today. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Let's worship.
is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glories, King above all kings. Who makes the roar with holy thunder. Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glories, the King above all kings. For us today. Your amazing love. It brings our chaos back into order. I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for
all that you've done for me.
Amen. We serve such a great God, powerful God. Psalm 117 says, praise the Lord, all you nations. Praise him, all you people of the earth. For his unfailing love for us is powerful. The Lord's faithfulness endures forever. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for the word. I believe.
Like I'm surrounded, but I'm look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't get weary in well-doing. He's fighting with you. The devil wants you to think you're alone, that God's not hearing your prayer. Well, that's a lie. When you don't think he's moving, he's moving. He's doing something. Thank you, Lord. And this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. And this is how I fight my battles. And this is how. And this is how I fight my battles. And this is how I fight my battles. And this is how I fight my battles. And this is how.
It may look like. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Hey!
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Yeah!
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. And this is how. This is how I fight my battles.
You and God, you're the majority.
And this is how I fight my battles. This is how.
One more time, this is how.
This is how I fight my battles. And this is how I fight my battles. And this is how I fight my battles. And this is how.
Hallelujah. We won't be defeated. We won't be defeated in his name. There's victory in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, there's power. In Jesus' name, there's strength. In Jesus' name, there's healing. Hallelujah. Woo. Hallelujah.
Our God would say to his people today, I will make a way when there seems no way. I am a mighty God. Your part is to praise me right through the storm. Remember, the walls fell down when the people praised me. The waters will part and the walls will fall down when you praise me, saith the Lord. I am a way maker and I am surrounding you with my love today. Absorb my love, for you are going to need my love. You cannot face this world without my love, for you will falter, you will fail, you will crumble neath the load, but I will make a way for you today if you will trust me, saith the Lord.
Holy, holy.
love you, Jesus. We adore you. You are our everything, our breath, our living water. Your name is power.
Thank you, Jesus.
Rhonda, I'm not ready to stop yet.
Okay.
Let's sing just a little more.
Filled
guys, let's just worship.
With wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy.
Intentional praise this morning. Hallelujah.
Can you take a moment just right where you are and just give God some praise?
Thank you.
Amen. You know, there's moments like that when we're in worship and God chooses to speak to us that you have there should be a moment of awe across this church, that we as His children get to hear His voice. Amen. That He speaks directly to you because He loves you. And that word was to all of us, but I specifically feel in my spirit that there's a few people in here that word is specifically for.
Yes.
That feel lost, that feel like you can't face tomorrow, that feel like they're just full of pain, hurt, and you don't know where to turn. And I just want to specifically say this morning that is the Lord beckoning you to Him. That is the Lord calling you to His presence. Amen. And that you don't have to be, although this is the perfect environment to host His presence, we don't have to be in service to feel His presence. But you, no matter where you're hurting, If it's the middle of the night and you're in your bedroom and you're by yourself and it's dark and your heart is hurting, you can call out and begin to worship the King of Kings. And His presence will fill that room. And in His presence is healing power. Amen. Thank you, Lord. You can be seated. Thank you, Lord. So we gather this morning as family, and I want to welcome you to First AG Inverness. And if you're a regular attender, thank you for continuing to attend. And if you're new here this morning, my wife and I, as your lead pastors, Steve and Jessica Miller, we welcome you, and we're so glad that you're here with us today. And we hope that today, as you attend, that the Lord does something special for you. Maybe it has happened already, or maybe it's going to happen in the sermon. But as you leave here today, that something will be different in your life because of what you've experienced in this room today. And that's our desire, that's our prayer for you, that's our hope for you this morning. We're going to continue to worship with our tithes, our offerings, our giving this morning. But I'd also like to ask you, if you're a regular attender or if it's your first time, to grab one of our Connect cards out of the seat. Just fill it out with as much information as you're comfortable giving us. Drop it in the offering as it comes by. And if you are that first-time guest, make sure and mark first-time guest on the top right-hand side on the front. Just let us know that you joined us, and we want to send you a letter just welcoming you to the church. But the most important part of this Connect card, the basically we could do away with everything else, but the most important part on this card is on the back. And on the back it has a space for you to fill in your prayer requests, your praise reports, and we want to do life with you. We want First AG to be a place where believers come together and do life together. So we want to know when you're hurting, we want to know when you need prayer, and we want to know when God meets that need. Amen. We want to pray for you and praise with you when God meets that need. So if you would, and you have a prayer request in your life, would you fill out that card and just drop it in? And like I always say, if it's private and you don't want one of our prayer teams to see it, you can just mark private on there, and it won't go any further than my desk. So my desk is it, and Jessica and I will pray for your need privately. So if you have a private request, just write that on there. Otherwise, if you would just get your offering to the Lord ready this morning, we're going to ask our ushers to go ahead and come down and get ready to collect our offering. I haven't said anything about the process of the building in a little while, and we've had a lot of other priorities we've been working on, but I want to let you know that this week, at the end of this week, the bathroom in the nursery will be completely brand new. It will be completely remodeled. Amen. And I want to thank Reamer Permenter for doing that work for us. We've got everything there ready to go, and he's going to be doing that this week. Of course, he was probably swayed by his beautiful wife, Jennifer, who is our nursery director. So I think she might have had more to do with it than I did. But either way, we're okay with it. We're just glad it's getting done. Amen. So we're excited about that. And then we'll have two of our air conditioners will be repaired this coming week. So we had, when we got here, there were 6 air conditioning units that were out. 2 of them will be repaired this week. So we're excited about that. Amen. God is moving here at First AG. Amen. Go ahead. Give them some praise. I want to welcome those who join us online as well. I never want to leave you out, and you're part of our family. You join us every week. You pray with us. You give into the church, and we're excited to have you as well. Just blessings today. If you would take your offering in your hand, let's just offer it up to the Lord this morning. No matter how you give, you may give online, and if you give online and you don't have anything to put in the bag this morning, you can just raise your hand right where you are and just offer that to the Lord as well. But let's just pray over our offerings this morning. Father, we worship you today. We give you all praise and glory. We thank you for your presence that's in this place. I thank you, Father, that you've already moved, but you're not done with us yet. You're going to continue to move on us throughout the remainder of this service. Father, I pray over every giver, every tither in this room, Lord, that you would bless them according to the principles that are laid out in your word. Father, that you would move in their lives. And Lord, as you say, you will repay the giver, you'll repay the tither, Father. But we know that it's not always monetarily, Lord, as some say. But Lord, we welcome any way that you want to bless us and move in our life. If you want to move in our marriages, we'll take it. If you want to move in our children's lives, we'll take it. If you want to move in our relationships, we'll take it. If you want to move in our households, we'll take it, Father. However you want to move on us, Lord, we just want your presence. In the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen.
Oh, when I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. Oh, when I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and he turned me around, how he placed my feet, yes he did, on solid ground. Oh, it makes me wanna shout hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory.
Come on.
All the honor, all the praise. It makes me wanna shout hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. With the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost.
Oh, when I
think about the Lord, how he takes me up and he turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, it makes me want to shout hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, Lord, your word. Of all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. It makes me want to shout hallelujah.
Woo!
Thank you, Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory, all the honor, all the praise.
What do you think about when you think about the Lord? What he's done for you, what he's going to do for you, what he's going to do in your family, what he's going to do in your finances. He's not done, he's just getting started. Oh, hallelujah, Lord, you're so worthy this morning. Woo! We give you all the praise. One more time, whatever's on your heart.
Oh, when I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, and how he healed me to the uttermost. And when I think about the Lord, and how he picked me up, he turned me around, how he placed my feet.
About you, but for me, I'm glad that I'm not preaching today because I am wrecked. Do you ever get just overwhelmed with His presence?
Many know that God is a good God. And I'm not talking about God being a good God just sometime, y'all. I'm talking about God being a good God all the time. I'm not trying to pump you up. I'm just trying to encourage you. I don't care what you're going through or how it looks or what it looks like or how the whatever the doctor says does not matter. What manifests is what God says. And God has the final word in all our lives. You know, God is a good God. I cannot emphasize that enough to tell you that how good our God is and how much He loves you. He loves you so much that He died on the cross just for you. He shed His blood just for you. He's good. And He deserves all your praises. Some say that we don't need to praise in all this loud and crazy ways. I heard it all said that that's not necessary. Maybe it's not necessary for them, but it's necessary for me. It's necessary because this is what I do. I know how to praise Him. And He deserves your praise. Ah, yalalabo. Excuse me, Pastor. I'm sorry. But I just know that God deserves all our praises. It don't matter how many tears you shed. It don't matter what you went through. God has been right there. Every time you fail, He picked you up. And that's enough for us to praise Him. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. We did not come here just to warm these benches. It's not about us warming these benches. It's about encouraging one another, loving on one another, being concerned about one another. Just a smile to one another. You may not know your neighbor, but just smile at them. You'll be surprised how mouth just connects. You know, God has blessed me. When I look down, that sun just moved me. When I look down through the years and see what God has brought me. For 67 long years, God has been good to me. He's been better to me, Pastor, than I've been to myself. And if I can never tell you nothing else, if you never hear me say nothing else, every time you get, every chance you get, every opportunity you get, no matter where you are or who's around, give God the praise. Hallelujah. Open your mouth and give him praise.
I want to introduce to you, church, this is my sister, Lucille. Lucille has decided to make this church her home and came and told me about a month ago. And we welcome her. We're so excited to have her. I was wondering this morning why the Lord didn't give me any words. And I thought, well, I guess because I'm not preaching. I guess I just don't have any words today. The Lord gave me lots of tears this morning. But I didn't have any words, and that's because he gave Lucille some words. Amen. Amen. So grateful for that word. So, church, we have been in a series this month that I planned for the last several months called This Is Us. And it's just a series that deals with our everyday life, our relationships, our marriages, our children, the things that we deal with. We talked about singleness, and then last week we talked about marriage, and then I asked Pastor Kennie Berger to fill this Sunday for Jess and I because we were previously scheduled to be at another church for the date was set a year ago, even before we ever knew that we were going to be here with you. We had a date set, and so I had asked Pastor Kennie Berger to fill this spot for me this week and speak on family. So our date got canceled, which I'm glad because I get to be here to hear Pastor Kennie speak this morning. So would you give a warm welcome to our own Pastor Kennie Berger?
Thank you, man. Amen. Wow. Sister Lucille, there's only one thing wrong with what you just did, is I have to follow that. Holy moly, we might as well just take up another offering and go home. I started to give you my notebook and say, you're on page three. Just keep going. My goodness. Thank you so much, Pastor Steve. I appreciate the opportunity. It's an awesome thing when someone asks you to fulfill and stand behind their pulpit. And I don't take it lightly. Thank you, God. I'm also not used to these shackles. I'm used to a lapel mic, so bear with me. And the poor guy's up in the sound booth. I've got so many slides, he's going to have a blister on his finger for hitting the vents. We tried a remote, and it didn't work, but I'm a teaching pastor, and I want to inundate the message with Scripture because I want you to know that what I say is not opinion. It is what God said. And then that way you then can take what God said. I appreciate what Pastor Steve invited. What a wonderful subject. Family is not just important. They're everything. Everything. And the world has so misconstrued it that now people have done it wrong for so long that they get a knee jerk when you bring up Scripture to where God said how to run your family. They go, no, that can't be correct because there's too many things wrong with it. Too much potential of abuse. But God is never wrong. The way God designed it is always the best way to do it. always the best way to do it. His plan is always better than ours. I recognize the danger as soon as if I get to the part where, you know, a family obviously includes a husband and wife, so marriage has to be part of it. And then it incorporates the children and it incorporates others. But it always starts at the foundation of a husband and wife. Otherwise, you're not a family. The family starts with a husband and wife. And then it expands. Well, I recognize the danger that soon as I get to a part where I even mention head of household, all of the men are going, oh, I like this guy. And then most of the ladies are going to roll their windows up, lock the door, and drift off to a happy place. And it's like, no, 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 no. Ladies, bear with me, indulge me. I promise you, you come out ahead at the end of this message. You come out ahead. The reason that that is there is because men have done it wrong. We've done it wrong. And God wants that to be corrected, especially in His family. In His family. Oh, it's become a national pastime of making fun of marriages. All of you can finish cliches like, if mama ain't happy, nobody's happy. Okay? It's always that way. It has become commonplace. I was on a job site yesterday, and a guy, a painter, was talking, young guy, he's in his 30s, and he mentioned his old lady. And I went, stop. I said, that's your wife. And he went, no, I didn't mean anything by that. It's just habit. She's only 37. I go, then don't call her your old lady. Call her your wife. Yeah. But at the same time, it's been abused on both sides. Why is it that when somebody's in the doghouse, it's always the man? If somebody has to sleep on the couch, it's always the man. Of course, and men abuse that. I heard of a guy that he looked at his wife and said, listen here, I'm the boss and you're nothing. To which she responded, that makes you the boss of nothing. And it'd be equal time. I heard of this couple and retired running across the U.S. in a motorhome. And she suddenly realized it was her husband's birthday. And she said, honey, oh my gosh, I forgot. Pull off at the next exit and let's go shop. I want to buy you a present for your birthday. And he said, honey, that's not necessary. I love you. Just love, honor, and obey. She thought a minute and said, no, take the next exit. Yeah. Uh-huh. She'd rather buy him a gift. Even to the level of politics. Winston Churchill, Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, the first lady parliament female was Lady Janet Astor, was her name, and she didn't like Churchill at all. And she said, Winston, if you were my husband, I would put poison in your tea. And Winston Churchill responded and said, if I was your husband, I would drink it. Yeah. And of course, my favorite is men finally go to heaven and you get to heaven and there's two gates. There's actually two. And one said, husbands who are head of their household. And the other one said, henpecked husbands. And behind the gate of henpecked husbands, the line was as far as the eye could see. And one man was over where head of household. And so all the men are clamoring and they finally say, fella, how did you do it? He said, you don't understand. My wife made me get in this line. Okay. Yeah, yeah. So. But in all seriousness, marriage and family is a sacred institution, and the world has messed it up so much that it has become commonplace. And we don't expect, that's why some people don't even want to get married. Because they say, why would I want to get married? It's probably just going to end someday. Well, that's the wrong way to go in. It's the wrong way to start. Melinda and I are not perfect by any means. And we've made mistakes in the past. Thank you, God, that He's corrected some of those mistakes. And I'm very thankful for my family. We have a very close family with my son and daughter and their kids. And this June will be 43 years that we've been married. Melinda is my wife. And you know what? I want another 43. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And we have some guests with us today. Of course, I pastored for 7.5 years. We retired our church. It was a wonderful thing. It was all in unity a year ago, November. And you've got some of the Northridge people here. I see Dave and Jeannie, and Jets is even here today. And I see Coy and Steve back there, and Joseph. And then we have some guests here, Mark and Deanne, Mark and Vicky and Peggy. So we got 13 here today from old Northridge people. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Okay. Is the guy in the booth ready? I'm just going to, again, stay ahead of you. The secret to a great family. There is a secret. There's something missing is why the family and marriages are like they are. And we're going to come on that today. The first verse is Proverbs 18. I don't expect you note takers. I apologize right up front. You're not going to be able to keep up taking notes. I'd write down maybe the scripture verse itself. But it said, a man who finds a wife finds a good thing. A good thing. And obtains favor from the Lord. Notice he has connected favor with a marriage. See, at times we know all the verses that support our point of view of who's in charge and what our responsibilities are. We find all of those verses that benefit us, and we don't always read the rest of the verse. And so here it says, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor of the Lord. If you want favor in your marriage and in your family, you have to do it God's way. You have to do it God's way. Thank you, Lord. So if we were to define family, it says a group of persons related by marriage and blood and generally living together in the same household. In the Western world, it traditionally consists of a man and a wife and their children. Well, I got news for you. God's view of marriage is one man and one wife. That's it. Now, politically, we've made it all kinds of stuff. It is a sad commentary when the owner of Chick-fil-A is ostracized by simply making a stand and say that he believes in traditional marriage, and then he gets, by that stand, gets labeled as hate. And there are universities and shopping malls that have forbidden Chick-fil-A from opening up a shop because they say he represents hate. And see, that's the devil's tactic. The man didn't say he hated anything. And see, I don't care if a significant other relationship in secular terms in our nation is allowed to have tax breaks on the property that they live in or on their income, or they're allowed to visit in the hospital because they're a relationship and they have permission to do that based on privacy. I don't have a problem with that, but you don't have to destroy the sanctity of marriage to do that. Keep the sanctity of what God said is marriage is unchangeable. Unchangeable. You can do all that other stuff if you want. But see, they want to destroy the marriage relationship in order to accomplish something else. And it's not necessary. It's not necessary. Help us, Lord Jesus. You know the Lord's coming back soon, right? And it said in the last days they'll call good evil and evil good. And you'll see it. All you got to do is flip on the news and you see, oh, Jesus, it's getting closer. It's getting closer. In Bible times, the family unit was much larger. I'm building a foundation here. The ancient world, the extended family would go out beyond that to even concubines and female slaves and so forth. Those were in biblical times. But in our time, it's the focus of a close family, the normal family foundation, is your own husband, wife, and children. But then the man making the decisions within the house was called father. He didn't have to be the oldest male in the house. It was who was designated as father, you see scriptures of Father Abraham, Father Abraham, Father Jacob. They had people that were in leadership positions, then were designated as father. And then he was honored and respected, and it was his word is what you went by. When Jacob and his family went to Egypt, do you know there was only 66 to 70 people? And they were starving in Canaan. And so they went to Egypt. You know the story. Joseph was over there and it got it all worked out. And then they stayed there for 400 years. And when they came back, there was 2 million of them with most of the wealth of Egypt coming with them, because the people of Egypt, the scriptures tell us and history tells us, they loved those Hebrew people. It was the king. And they were the ones getting nervous. Hey, they're producing too. There's too many of them. And they can politically outvote us and have too much power. We got to make life miserable for them. And thus finally sent Moses as a deliverer to send them out. And then they could come back to the promised land 2 million strong. And come back to the land of promise that God had given them. But now there's 2 million of them. And they got all kinds of resources to come back to that land of promise. So you look at the issue of when they're there and starving and famine has come in, and many people said, where is your God? Why are you starving? Why didn't God just give you a healthy crop? It's not hard to feed 70 people. God had a plan for them. Sometimes when something is happening within your life, and you don't think it lines up with your intellectual, earthly, secular understanding, trust God. He's got a plan that's higher than your plan. And so here it took starvation. It took famine to get them out of there. He knew he was bringing them back. He knew he was bringing them back, and he had a plan. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. His design for family goes all the way back into Genesis. We can go to the next slide. It said, the Lord God said, it's not good for man to be alone. And he had created man. And he created him in his image. Later, though, as he created all of the rest of the animals and the natural world, and he said it was good, but he tried to find a helpmate for Adam, and he couldn't find one, and it said he had to make another one. So all of the things that he created, he said, wasn't good enough. I'm going to have to make something else. And thus he made Eve. And it said he brought her to him. And Adam was asleep. Remember, he set him aside and put a deep sleep on him, took one of his ribs, and then he made Eve. That means, men, we didn't have anything to do with it. See, totally from God, and he purposely set man. Now, if he'd allowed Adam to take part, Adam would have abused that for the rest of history. He set him aside and put him asleep, and then he made a helpmate for them. But then he said, and then he brought them together to be one flesh. So that meant now, in all of that glory and grandeur that Adam might have felt, now when he brought Eve, it was not to be two people, it was to be one. And so all of that honor and glory upon man, he said he created them, plural word, them. No longer to be separated. And even in our marriage ceremonies, he said, what God in the scripture, what God has put together, let no man separate. They are one. Go to the next slide. I'm so used to just clicking my clicker. But there's the verse where he talks about that. And he brought her to Adam. So God's design is that they are one. He does make the man the ruling authority in that position. That means the decision maker. That's like any circumstance, even in business. You can surround yourself with advisors, but somebody's got to make the final decision. And guess what? He alone will hold liability for that decision. You can receive as much input as you want to make the decision. But once the leader, whether it's the CEO of a company or the man within the household, yes, you take input. You don't just shut out the wife. You take input. But once you make the decision, you alone answer to God for the decision. Most men want the authority of the position of being head. They don't want the liability that goes with it. Help us, Lord Jesus. So God said it wasn't good. He brought woman to him, and they, in Genesis 2, 24, are still there yet, and made them one flesh. The institution of marriage, the next verse in Matthew, Jesus refers back to that of where he said, don't you remember how God created a man and a woman and they became one flesh? And he reminded them of that institution. So Jesus himself, if it's in your Bible, it's in red letters. Because Jesus said it. It wasn't Paul, it wasn't Peter, it wasn't John. It was Jesus himself referring back to that marriage institution. In the Old Testament, they were forbidden to marry foreigners. They knew that those foreigners didn't worship the same God. Now we run into an issue. Paul makes that. Turn the next slide. 2 Corinthians, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. A believer has no business in a relationship with a non-believer. Do you hear what I said? If you live your life to glorify God, how can you do that to become one flesh with someone who doesn't glorify God? And he goes on to say, what is light to do with darkness? What does Baal have to do with righteousness? And he just makes all of these comparisons. Well, but you know, when we're dating, I'll get him to go to church. Statistics show that when a believer and a non-believer are in a relationship, it pulls down the believer faster than it brings up the non-believer. In fact, that believer has already compromised their commitment to God to even be flirting with that situation, which is a sign that their spiritual strength may not be strong enough. And advice would say, don't try it. Don't try it. Because if that is a holy union, it has to be one. You know the covenant, the marriage covenant, when you make a marriage vow, it is not to your wife or husband. The wedding vow is to God on behalf of your wife or husband. And of course, scriptures tell us don't make a vow if you're not willing to keep it. Don't make one and then break it. It's better not to make a vow than to make a vow and then break that. Help us, Lord Jesus. Some didn't take that advice. In 1 Kings, the next verse, Solomon, we know him as the wisest man that was ever on the earth. You remember the story, God asked him, you want wealth or you want wisdom? And he said, I'd rather have wisdom. And God said, since you could have asked for anything and I would have given, I'm going to give you both. Solomon was known as the wealthiest man. If you now do a present day net worth of what he is still, Solomon is the wealthiest man in human history and was known as the wisest man. Well, it's a sad commentary to go to the end of the scripture and the end of Solomon's story because his heart was turned by all of those wise. He even built temples to false gods and so forth. And the Lord came through a prophet and told him, I'm going to take your kingdom away from you. But not from you, but from your son, because of your father David. So not to humiliate his father, see, the honor and the respect of his father, God himself said, I'm taking your kingdom away from you, but it'll be from your son, not from you. Because your heart was turned away from me. And who turned it? All of his wives. He started involving himself in order to please the wives, I'm assuming, then he was building temples to false gods and so forth. He didn't finish the wisest man on the earth. He didn't follow his own wisdom. The very existence in the country, it says, was threatened by the breakdown of the home. Welcome to America. You want to know right now, if you stop and think about it, all of the protests and the things that are happening within, you turn on the news and you see all of this stuff. Obviously, all of those are children of some family that didn't honor God and didn't raise them right. And so now they're by majority thinking that they just want to change society. All of that came down to now is a result of the breakdown of the home. If we'd have simply did it God's way, we wouldn't be in the mess that we're in. Help us, Lord Jesus. Thank you, God, that he said as the times would get worse, he would shorten the days for our sake. because it's going to get even worse and even worse. Micah 3, or 7, excuse me, 7, he's got it up there. Said, do not trust a friend or a mouth that lies within your bosom. And it goes on to say, for a son dishonors father, a man's enemies are of his own household. The last line, a man's enemies are inside his own household. What a commentary to that. And notice he stumbled onto something there. A son dishonors his father. There's the breakdown. There's the crack in the foundation, if you will. Some of you know I'm a general contractor by trade. I have two or three jobs. Now I just have two instead of three after not being pastoring now for a year. But in a foundation of a construction site, the foundation is critical to everything. If the foundation is compromised, the rest of the structure is compromised. Well, here we have a foundation we're supposed to be building upon. And yet we tend to take it lightly. You know, most of the condition of the body of Christ, it's a sad commentary. Everybody wants fire insurance, you understand? Nobody wants to go to hell. But they don't necessarily want to glorify God in their life. That's an entirely different question. How many times, Pastor, you might have run into this already. I've had people come in and ask questions. Well, can I do this and still be a Christian? Oh, can I do this and still be saved? And it's like, why are you even asking the question? Why are you looking for a reason to keep just as much of the world in your life, thinking that you can drag around that old dead man? You know what? That dead body is going to smell. You understand what I'm saying? No, when you make a resolve that you give your heart to the Lord, it is an eternal decision. The Bible says, without repentance, there is no forgiveness of sin. Repentance is not confession. Here, you know, we make fun sometimes of our Catholic brothers and sisters where they'll have confession on a night and then during the week live any way they want. You know what? We do the same. We think because we confess a sin that we're going to turn and live different. No, it's not what you say up here on the altar that saves you. It's how you live when you walk out the door. Let God change you. And that means, it says, to walk in newness of life. If you talk the same, look the same, drink the same, eat the same, treat other people the same, tell me that anything changed. And yet, we're supposed to be the salt of the earth. People are supposed to watch us. Amen. To the point that they see your life and say, oh my goodness, what is it about that relationship with their God? I want to know who that God is. Yeah. That's how it was intended to be. Of course, you've heard that, again, cliche that says, if you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Satan doesn't care if you go to church. Satan doesn't care if you read the Bible, as long as you don't do what it says. Didn't the devil quoted Scripture to Jesus in his temptation? It's not reading it. It's not coming to church. It's a changed life that glorifies God because of the fellowship of the church and the reading of His Word. Let it have its effect. Amen. Malachi brings up another verse. I'm going to try to read that because that was too important. It said, and this is the second thing. You cover the altar of the Lord with tears, with weeping and crying, so He does not regard the offering anymore, nor receive it with goodwill from your hands. Yet you say, for what reason? Because the Lord has been witness between you and the wife of your youth with whom you have dealt treacherously. Another verse, we'll get to it, says that your prayers be not hindered. If your prayers are not being answered and there are things in your life that are falling apart and your marriage is a wreck and your business is a wreck and your body is a wreck, you might have to look back in some soul searching and see if you're treating your family the right way and God's way, because that within itself can be a forfeit of what God wants to do. You can't have the benefit of God's relationship with no responsibility of God's relationship. Help us, Lord Jesus. First Peter, or let's go on to Corinthians 11, the next verse. Here we go. I don't like this pulpit. It's not bulletproof, is it? It's too open. It's like, oh my. Help us, Lord Jesus. You know, I was talking to Pastor Eddie. He had a wonderful message Wednesday night and used Ephesians 5. And that's where it talks about the husband being the head of the wife. And then Pastor Steve asked me to do family that wouldn't. You know what? He's up to something. He wanted me and Pastor Eddie to deal with that so that he wouldn't have to. Oh, my. My goodness. No, we know better. But he says, I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. For a man indeed ought not to cover his head, since, and he goes on to talk about covering yourself in a place of worship. And that's why many times women would wear hats or things on their head, because their hair is their glory, and not to bring glory to themselves, they would cover that. But you know, even that gets abused. I do missionary work, and in Honduras, they are very male-dominant society. Some of those old fundamental churches still have the men sitting on one side and the ladies sitting on the other. And of course, my missionary mentor, John Taylor, they love him. Well, he loves to rock their theology. He comes in and sits on the ladies' side. Just so he could show them they're doing it wrong. But then here comes the pastor's wife, and she's got this wonderful lace covering to her, and it's literally a train. I mean, it goes 4 feet behind her. Wait, I thought the covering was to not to bring attention to yourself. And so John gets up and he goes, look at us. Y'all are competing on your humility. You know, who can look the most humble? My goodness, help us, Lord Jesus. So he goes on and he says there that there has to be a covering. There has to be an authority to cover the wife. In fact, let's go back to that previous verse. Because he goes on through at the very last end. For this reason, a woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. It's like, what the heck does that mean? Because of the angels. What have they got to do with it? But see, you know, there is protocol within the heavenly realm. And so it's like if there is a symbol of authority, she is covered by the man the way God designed it. Men are to protect their wife. They're to protect them. And for her being submitted under her husband, there's her protection. Even the angels recognize it. If you've ever had a salesman knock on your door or somebody complaining, can I speak to the wife? And said, no, you can't. You will speak to me. You will not speak to my wife. See, we're supposed to be their shield and their protection. And again, we messed that up. Go to the next verse then. And it says, nevertheless, neither is man independent of woman, nor woman independent of man. For the woman came from man, and even so man also comes through woman. Isn't it funny how God knew exactly what he was doing? Woman was taken from man, but just in case, men, you thought that made you something special, you had to be then, every man after that had to be born through a woman. And I am thankful for it, too. How many men are glad you're a man? Yes, whoo, thank you, Jesus. Don't want none of that. 10 years ago, when I was 55, I had a goal in my life of running a marathon, and I'd started running and running and running, and I finally got up to a half. In fact, this is Daytona weekend, right? True story. I have actually officially raced at Daytona International Speedway. It was on foot. I ran what's called the Daytona Half Marathon. It started inside the track. We ran around the track and out the tunnel and out to the beach and back and ran that half marathon. Got to take your picture in the winner's circle and all that kind of stuff. I have a beautiful little medal for being an official finisher. So I have officially raced at Daytona. Yeah. Help us, Lord Jesus. So then go to next 1 Peter 3:7. Here's the verse that we misuse the most. Husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding. Give honor to the wives as to the weaker vessel. Oh man, all the men's ears just perked up. Say, yeah, I've heard that verse. We use it over and over and over again. As the weaker vessel, as being heirs together the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. But what you didn't see was the most important part of that verse. He said, giving honor to the wife as the weaker vessel. Wait a minute, men. You cannot honor your wife and demean her at the same time. You cannot honor her and belittle her at the same time. It is impossible. So that couldn't have been what he meant, was just to emphasize she's weaker. It couldn't. I like to put in the word vulnerable. And thus, she deserves your protection. If you honor her, you will never do anything to her that would harm her in any way, if you're honoring her. In fact, as a teacher of all those years, I love to do word pictures and visuals. So I have something here. This would represent us men. You know, we're built like shipping crates. Coated in leather. We can handle punishment, the weather. You're built for warfare. Our problem is we tend to use those gifts and those designs for warfare against our own family, and that's not how it was designed. There was a book one time that said, Tender Warrior. I disclose to you, I read the cover and the preface. I didn't read the whole book. But the preface of the book was, men, oh yeah, it's like that shield and that armor and that sword, it's intended to check it at the door. It is intended for you to defend your family, not to harm your family. Don't ever use those weapons of warfare and those defensive tactics against your own wife or your kids. Children should never be afraid of their father. Ever. They should know that maybe that doesn't mean you don't discipline them. The Bible says if a parent doesn't discipline their child, she hates her child. That's what it actually says. If you love your children, you'll discipline them. But in love for them. Not just wait until you reach the boiling point and then you start throwing things in the room. That's not it. So see, if we have women a weaker vessel, here's what's probably meant by that, is their worth. The reason we protect you is because you're so valuable. You are, now this is not a Ming Dynasty piece of China that's worth millions, you understand? $2.50 from the thrift store. Okay, that's trying to make a point, okay? So here, this is, you are so valuable to us. Our job, these should never collide with each other, ever. It should be protection when the storms come. When the storms come, the Father protects them and shields them. He takes the hit. He takes the scars. He takes the damage because he loves his wife so much. She should never have to face that. And then, done right, yeah, also vulnerable, also delicate, also can be damaged and are to be protected by the Father. And yet so often we use all of that. Yeah, men are supposed to have skin of leather and we make emotion, you know, our decisions are intellectually more than emotional and so forth. It's because many times a right decision can't have emotion part of it. You have to decide what's right because it's right. And that's why God wanted the man to make the final decision. Now, he should take it in consideration for protecting his family and protecting it. And then say, now, Now you can bring it, but not until then. Not until then. Help us, Lord Jesus. So the secret to a great family is honor. We've lost it. When President Reagan died and he was in the rotunda lying in state, thousands of people lined up to come and see the casket. And I remember watching the television, and here came a man, I don't know if he was Japanese or Chinese, but a man was carrying, must have been a photograph he might have had of Reagan, and he came around to in front of the casket and he stopped. There's a whole line behind him. And he stopped and he bowed. That was his culture. They knew how to honor people. And he bowed a second time. Total silence, didn't say a word. All the line is backing up behind him. And a third time. And not too far in the line past that, it's a 30-year-old male with his hat turned sideways, chewing gum, walking through like, oh, there's a dead man. Do you know in Japan, they say for the first 3 years of school, they don't even give them a test. They don't test their children in that early age. For 3 years, they teach them honor and respect and protocol. They clean their own classroom. They sweep their own floor. They wipe down their own desk. You think in a Japanese school, there's gum all over the floor and stuck to the bottom? No, they taught them respect of property and person. And yet they're some of the highest intellectually performing students around the world. And yet, what? They don't even test them in the first three grades? No, they're teaching something far more important than intellect. It's honor. Honor. Help us, Lord Jesus. So the secret is honor. Even to the point, now I threw this verse in. Go to the next verse. Leviticus. You shall rise before the gray-headed and honor the presence of an old man and fear the Lord. I fear God, I'm your Lord. Well, we don't want to exercise that today. We would have you. I could step out and you could all stand. We don't do that anymore, I think, because it's too confusing since the invention of hair color. We don't know who to stand for. You know what I mean? So we just don't do that anymore. But it says we should honor the older generation and honor them. 1 Timothy says, let the elders who rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in word and doctrine. Pastor Steve, come here for a minute. Stand right here. You're taller than I am. We are to honor those, especially those who labor in word and doctrine above us. Amen. I got news for you. God Himself placed this man in this church to be the senior pastor. That's the scary part. And what that means is we are to honor this man. If you disagree with the way he's doing things, you ask God to change that in your heart, or maybe it would be better for you to worship somewhere else. It is not your position to tell him to change. He can surround himself with elders and advisors to seek God's face, but the decision is his and his alone, and in honor you represent that, and you support that. Thank you, God. Love you, man. Now, you don't have to stand when he enters the room, but sometimes it'd be a good idea. We've lost honor. Proverbs 12 says, an excellent wife is the crown of her husband. Proverbs 19 says, houses and riches are an inheritance from fathers, but a prudent wife is from the Lord. Proverbs 31 says, who can find a virtuous wife? Her worth is far more than rubies. Her worth. I have another visual. I have a $50 bill. Would anybody like that, Rich? Okay. Why would you want this? Because it's $50, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, wait. Okay, now pick it up and hand it back to me. Okay. Okay. Do you still want it?
Yes, sir.
It's all wrinkled up.
It's still.
I saw somebody do this, by the way, and I thought, I can't wait for the opportunity. Why do you still want it? It has been wrinkled up to an ugly mess.
Oh, I can take care of that real easily.
Okay. Well, wait a minute. What if I...
No, don't do that. No, no.
What if I do a permanent scar? Do you still want it?
Yes, still want it.
Why do you... It's not only wrinkled up in a mess, but it's got a permanent scar on this. Why do you still want it?
It's going to spend just as easily.
It's still worth $50.
Yes, sir, it is.
Wait a minute. Who do you think you are? You're nothing but a piece of paper. You've never done anything for me. I wish I would have never come into a relationship with you. Do you still want it?
Yes, sir.
I have tried to convince it that it is worthless. Why do you still want to use it?
It still has the same value.
Okay, so its value is not made of tall and skinny, short and fat, wrinkled, scarred, or what somebody in the past said. It never lost its worth. It's worth. Its worth is based on who made it. And if God made you, your worth, ladies, is not based on some unscrupulous man telling you who you were in the past, or some other person telling you what you were good at or bad at, or didn't like your looks, or didn't like this or that and the other, or the scars that he made have nothing to do with your worth. Your worth is in who made you and in God. Here, thank you very much. You can have that. Okay. It's still $50. It will still buy $50 worth of groceries or gas. Doesn't matter. Thank you, Jesus. Worth. Colossians 3, wives, submit to your own husbands as is fitting to the Lord. And then it says, husbands, love your wives and do not be bitter toward them. Notice how something goes wrong, and then there's this antagonistic relationship of short answers and criticisms and so forth, and it just gets deeper and deeper. It says, husbands, love your wife. My twin brother, he lives over, some of you knew, Lenny used to be here back when they first built the church in 85. And I do have an identical twin, so if there's ever any bad things you remember, it was him. Okay. Well, anyway, he's over there one day. He had a little dog named Maggie, a little dachshund, and he came home, and he comes walking through the door, and of course, God really knew what he was doing when he made dogs. And so this little dog got all excited, and Maggie's running laps around the living room, and he picks up, and she's licking him in the face. And my sister-in-law says, Lenny, I think you're happier to see that dog than you are me. And he said, well, if I came through the door and you got all excited and ran laps around the living room and licked me in the face, I'd be glad to see you too. Husbands, love your wife. Why is it that now it seems to be not commonplace? I still open the door for my wife. In fact, I've been out in a shopping circumstance and see a lady coming and open the door. I've had every response you can think of. Everything for some would say thank you. Others just walk through the door and don't acknowledge you whatsoever. I've actually had someone said, no thanks, I got this. She actually refused to have me hold the door for her, thinking that was apparently a sign of weakness to her, that she was capable of opening the door on her own. It's like, no, you don't get it. You don't get it. You ladies are special, and we want to honor you, and we should at every front, no matter where that comes. Verse 20, children, obey your parents in all things. Now we incorporate the rest of the family, which is pleasing to the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. There's that thing again of how we're made of leather and we're made for warfare. That's to defend the family, not to harm the family. And sometimes when dads lose perspective, then at times they can do irreversible harm. Only God Himself can heal some of the scars of what children have to go through. Help us, Lord Jesus. So the real secret is honor. It's no longer taught. I remember one time Kurt, my son, was just a little guy, and I heard him getting a little mouthy with Melinda, and I went, whoa, 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 stop. I said, Kurt, no one talks to my wife like that, not even her son. He had never looked at it. He thought, that's mom. He had never thought of it. That's also dad's wife. And I said, nobody talks to her like that. Sad commentary. I would such a strong stance against that, and yet I became the one that would violate it myself and catch myself talking to her in ways of raising my voice in an intense fellowship that we would have. And I would abuse. You know, I was a soccer coach for years. I can project my voice. When you have to talk to somebody 60 yards away, I can push the volume. You understand what I'm saying? And it's not like on the road where whoever has the biggest horn wins the intersection. Sometimes we think whoever can yell the loudest wins the argument. No, that's not it. And so as much as I would try to enforce it and instill it in my kids, I caught myself violating it myself. But the Lord's very gracious. But you say, yeah, but Pastor Kennie, if you just lavishly love your wife like that, won't they get spoiled? Well, you know the difference in blessed and spoiled is if they're grateful for what you do. Can you give your kids too much? Not if they're grateful for it, no. Can you overdo it in loving your wife? Not if they're thankful for it, no. You can't overdo it. You can't. And it's how they respond to that. Behold, children, Psalm 127, children are a heritage of the Lord. A man's pride will bring him low, but a humble spirit will retain honor. There's that word again. A humble man brings honor. See, we're so afraid that our male nature is going to be insulted that, you know, men walk around with a chip on their shoulder, you know, and they got to be this tough guy kind of thing. And yet, no. The toughest man there is one that, one, can humble himself to God. And two, he can also admit when he's wrong. And if you've done somebody wrong, be man enough to tell them. And ask for their forgiveness. That's strength, is what that is. Back then in the ancient, in the Old Testament, the word patriarch was the word. It was the defined as rule of the father. Well, see, if a man was doing it right, then nobody is worried about God. I mean, the father making the decision, because his decision's probably going to be right. And men, I got news for you. If you're trying to get a lady's attention or your wife to love you, there's not a woman on the face of the earth that can turn down a godly man who loves God with all his heart. It's somewhere in the middle. The guy's the same. Every man would love to have a wife that fears God and her life is completely committed to the Lord. That is the most attractive thing about a person, is how much they love Jesus. In the fifth commandment, in Exodus, honor your father and your mother. And Jesus referred to that later and said it's the only commandment, the first commandment, with promise that your days would be long on the earth. Well, I decided I didn't want to die early of something, and I want to live long on the earth. So that tells me that the Word says that if I honor my mother and my father, my days would be long. Well, I'm going to take that opportunity. my mom and dad. I tried to honor them. After my dad passed away, then that means my mom, not only was she my mom, but she fell into the category of a widow, which the Bible says we are to take care of widows and orphans. So now it required me to even do more to take care of her. So guys, I've got some good news and some bad news. The good news is you are in fact given by God, you are head of the house and high priest of your home. Now here's the bad news. You are given by God the authority. You are the head of your house and the high priest of your home. See, it can be the good news or the bad news, depending on whether you're willing to take the liability that goes with it. The man is responsible, one, for the spiritual well-being. Ephesians 6 tells us, it talks about children obeying your parents and so forth. And at the very bottom, fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. It's the father's responsibility to train the children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Notice they didn't say anything about the mom or the wife right there. Husbands, dads, don't you make the mistake of sending your family to church. Take them to church. Take them to church. It's the man's responsibility. Unless you are medically, physically unable, then you should never let your family go to church without you. Well, I don't feel good. What's feeling got to do with it? That's what I love about ministering to men. Sometimes you talk to men and you go, before we start, do you want me to talk to you like a child or like a man? Well, none of them can say, well, go ahead and talk to me like a child. Every one of them will say, okay, talk to me like a man. But they know what's coming. Because you can look them in the eye and tell them the truth. Men, you're responsible. Think of this. Children only answer to God for themselves when they come the age of understanding. A child answers to God only for himself, but not for his mother or father. Moms, you answer to God for your life and for your children, but never for your husband. Guys, I got bad news. You are responsible for your relationship with God and your wife and your children. Welcome to the authoritative position. See? Again, we want the authority but not the liability. That's not how it should be. That's not how God intended it. We are to honor them. So it's the spiritual well-being. They say, look at these statistics. Going to the next, I've got to pick up speed. Statistics, next slide. 7%, if children get saved first, 7% of the rest of the family gets finally saved if the children were the ones saved first. But if mom or the wife was saved first, then 23% of those families ultimately come to the Lord. If the father or husband gets saved first, 94% of those families ultimately get saved. 94%. See, the children first, that's the Kennie Lenny circumstance. My mom and dad were saved in the past, and then they backslid. We were born into a non-Christian home at the time, and my brother and I got saved in our senior year of high school at Big Citrus High School. We came from Dixie Hollins High School in St. Pete that our 10th grade sophomore class alone was 869 students. And we came up here, 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th was 902. And we said, where's the rest of your school? But we got saved first. In fact, it was just this past January, thank you God, 48 years since I got saved. January 30th, 1972. Thank you God. Thank you God. And I got radically saved. I knew exactly what I got saved from. I was thankful for my salvation. In fact, I got a little perturbed going to church with church brats that would sit and talk during the service and pass notes and stuff. And I'm going, would you shut up? I can't hear what the guy is saying. There was parts of me that said, thank you for not raising me within the church for the danger that I would be calloused to the gospel message. Help us, Lord Jesus. Second responsibility is social. The father has a responsibility to develop social responsibility within his kids. That's why there's the next verse that brings out widows and orphans. And it says, next slide, protecting not only your own family but others, James 1:27, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, that we visit the orphans and widows in their trouble and keep one unspotted by the world. Because see, a widow or an orphan no longer has a covering. Their covering is gone. The dad is gone. The husband's gone. That's why the church is to protect widows and orphans. And it didn't say they had to be part of the church. You're to help widows and orphans who simply are widows and orphans. My brother ran a Christian foster care and adoption agency for years, the Berger Foundation. He placed 24 children in permanent Christian adoptive homes. He was talking to the head of Children and Family Services for the state of Florida. And that man, he said, Lenny, I'll make a statement to you. We as the government will take the blame for doing it wrong if the church will take the blame for not doing it at all. Lenny would go and get invited to come and speak, and there'd be all these people. You know, there's a difference to be anti-abortion versus pro-life. Those are two different things. People will stand on the street corner with a sign, anti-abortion. Abortion is killing, blah, blah, blah. Lenny would come and speak, and of course it was a right-to-life thing, and he'd go, okay, you're all here as pro-life. He said, my sign-up table to adopt is right over there. And not a single one of them would sign up. They came there to protest the travesty of killing babies, but would never sign up to help a mom raise one or adopt one into their own home. The church, we make a lot of noise, but we don't do anything about it. Help us, Lord Jesus. I have an adoptive granddaughter, by the way, and she's wonderful, and she's 4. And if I had time, I'd show you the clip of her singing Waymaker with her little guitar. Waymaker, promise. She loves Jesus. Thank you, God. The responsibilities of the father toward his son back in those old days was one, to have him have their son circumcised, which we could say making sure that he's in relationship with the Lord, pass his inheritance on to his firstborn, help him find a wife, and help him get a job. Yeah. I lived out here in the North North Citrus Hills at one time, and I noticed a lady next door. I didn't see a man around the house, and she had a big half acre like mine, and her yard was just all growing up. And so I was, now, mind you, I was having 3 jobs. And so I was mowing my lawn, and I thought, you know what? I'll just go over, and I mowed her yard. And oh, she came out, oh, Mr. Berger, thank you so much. And I said, well, ma'am, what is your circumstance? Are you divorced? Yes. Your husband? No, he's not. I'm divorced. He's long gone. I said, do you have any adult children? Oh, yes. I have a son. How old is he? 24. Where's he at? Oh, he lives here. Really? Why doesn't he mow your grass? Oh, well, he has a job. This is getting more difficult. And I said, well, ma'am, I have 3 jobs and I mow my yard and yours. I said, I didn't know your circumstance, so I mowed it this time, but I'm sorry. I will not be able to mow your yard again. I said, he pays you rent, doesn't he? Oh, well, no. How old is he? 24. Okay, so he's living at home free. He don't even mow your grass for you? Ma'am, you know you're not doing him any favors. He will forever be dependent upon other people. Right now, it's just you. I'm sorry, I won't be able to mow your yard anymore. The next week, he was mowing. Yeah. Help us, Lord Jesus. Third reason is economic. The father was provide for the needs of his family. And there's all kinds of scriptures about the lazy man. Apostle Paul dealt with that. They rebuked Christians who would not take care of their own. 1 Timothy brings that out. Matthew talks about how wonderful our Lord is as our Heavenly Father. Even the hairs on your head are numbered, Matthew 10:30. He protects his children and rescues them when they're in trouble. Hosea teaches them the way that they should go. Matthew 6:33, my life verse, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Then the family expanded to the clan. Your clan could be anybody you invited in. It wouldn't have to be blood. And from that, there was also every male had what was called a kinsman redeemer. You can go ahead and flip to the next one. Again, I'm going to pick up speed. There was a kinsman redeemer. That would be a relative that would come to your aid whenever it would happen. If a man ever had to sell his property to pay off his debts, his kindred redeemer could come and pay that debt and he'd get his land back because he's family. We see that in the wonderful story of Ruth. As you look in the book of Ruth, Boaz coming back to take care of Naomi, then it would benefit. Well, then he ultimately married Ruth. Well, what's wonderful, do you remember who Boaz was? Who was Boaz's mom? It was Rahab, the prostitute. She had, when the people came into Jericho, she put the ribbon in the window, and then she hid the spies that were there and so forth, and they said that she would be rewarded if she put it there, that danger would pass over them, and then she became part of God's family. Salmon was his name. He married her and had Boaz. Later, he becomes the kinsman redeemer for Ruth, marries Ruth, and has Obed. Obed has Jesse. Jesse has King David. Three generations later is King David from a prostitute. 14 generations after King David was the carrying away to Babylon, and 14 generations after that comes Jesus. Yes, 27 lines of generation as the great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandmother of Jesus himself was an ex-prostitute. What a wonderful story of restoration and forgiveness. God is never concerned about your past. He's concerned about your future. Don't ever let the devil talk you into saying that you don't have worth because of how you used to be. Just make sure you're no longer that person. Help us, Lord Jesus. The person, if you were ever captured and became a slave, or if you had to give, sell your stuff and become a slave because of your debts, you could be a slave and your kinsman redeemer could come and buy you back. If a person died childless, then if another kinsman redeemer, a brother, if she was childless, would marry his brother's wife and raise up a son to keep the family name alive. If the person, if a family member was murdered, your kinsman redeemer, we're talking in that day, was your avenger of blood, is what Goel was the translated word for kinsman redeemer. He would redeem your death. Well, look at the parallel in the family of God. Jesus, we sing that, my Redeemer lives. You don't realize the depth of that word. It wasn't that He wiped away your sin debt. Somebody had to pay it. You know, your sin doesn't disappear. Jesus had to pay for it with blood. And He's your Redeemer. If you've sold yourself as a slave to sin, He'll set you free. The Son sets free is free indeed. He is our next of kin. You can just start flipping through the verses. So now we have the family of God. We have to close with the family institution bridges out into the family of God itself in that parallel. When you become born again, you have a new father. You have a new name. Our sister Lucille, I'm so blessed by that lady. In fact, come here, Lucille, real quick. I know, forgive me of the time. I'm hurrying. I really am. Most beautiful thing about this lady is how much she loves Jesus.
Yes, I do. Bless you. Bless you.
Now, all of y'all that were here, y'all knew Lynn and Hazel Berger, but you knew the after Christ Lynn and Hazel Berger. You know Kennie and Lenny, and most of you. Now, Mark Harrison, he knew us before. Keep it to yourself. You wouldn't have known that I was raised in a home that used the N-word. You wouldn't know that my dad even picked up the paperwork and never filled it out or turned it in. I was raised in a home with that prejudice. But when I got saved, that was a root that had to be purged out of me. Purged out of me. And if there's any of it in you, it needs to be rooted out. If you know the last half of eeny, meeny, miny, moe, you might be more prejudiced than what you thought. Allow God to change you. There is no room for prejudice within God's family. I love this lady.
Love you too. Love you.
Thank you. That's my sister. She's more than a sister. She's a sister. She's a sister. That's right. That's why sometimes I like to sit the same side she does. I want the splash zone, you know, where she's at. Yeah. Closing with Romans 1:20, it says, although they knew God, they did not glorify Him as God, but their thoughts became futile. That's the condition of our society. A lot of people, I believe in God. Well, the Bible says demons believe and tremble. Believing in God, it doesn't accomplish anything. It's they don't glorify Him. You could interchange that word, honor Him as God. I was talking to my wife about this, and it's not to take away from the relationship with God, but I serve God not because of what He does for me, not because He saved me, not because He'll take care of me. I had to come to the resolve in my heart that He's God. That's why I worship Him, because of who He is. Then as I develop the relationship, those other things will come. But we worship Him, we glorify Him as God within our life. Do you think I want anything to interrupt the favor that's upon my life and my family? Why would I ever selfishly want to take charge of my own life? It isn't worth it. Dads, husbands, treat your wives right. Romans even says, greet one another with a holy kiss. Now, I had a friend of mine down in a church in Fort Myers, and he had a habit to go up and kiss ladies on the cheek when he gave them a hug. And I went to him one time, and everybody needs an accountability partner that'll look you in the eye and tell you truth. Every man needs an accountant, not a woman. Oh, every woman needs another woman, and every man needs another man that can look you in the eye and say, have you kept your thought life clean this week? Is everything okay in your marriage? Is everything going on in your life doing good? You need an accountability partner. And so I went to him and I said, Mike, I got a question for you. I said, I noticed that you only kiss the attractive ones. You know what he said? He goes, is it that obvious? Okay, so his heart was not in the right place. That's why some people have the restrictions. You do the side-by-side hug and all that kind of stuff. Sometimes that's necessary. If you can't keep pure thoughts and a healthy mind in order to show affection to one another, then don't do it. We don't know where you came from and what the devil has. We don't want him to have a foothold back in your life or anything. But it says, Romans 12:11, be kindly affectionate one another, giving honor. There's that word again. In honor, giving preference to one another. If we honor each other in the church, that's why you don't, I hope you don't come to church for what you receive. You should be behind this pastor and this ministry that you come to what you can contribute in worship, in giving, in serving. The other things will come along the way. But honor has to be there. You honor the leadership, but in your own home, you honor your wife, you honor your husband. Ladies, I got news for you. You treat your husband like a king, he can't help but treat you like a queen. Can't help himself. It's true. And the same thing with parents and children. Honor has to be restored. Ask God. Ask God. Now, men, if you're here with your wife, stand up. If you're here and your wife or family is next to you, stand up with them. Now, ladies, stand up there next to them. And husbands, I want you to turn and face her face to face and hold both hands. And I want you to repeat after me. Honey, forgive me for not honoring you the way that I should. I'm asking God to teach me how to do that better. Forgive me of the past. Our future will be different. In Jesus' name, Amen. Amen. Thank you, God. Pastor Steve.
Let's give a hand for Pastor Kennie Berger. Really grateful for that word, Pastor Kennie. Thank you so much for delivering that today and filling the pulpit. Folks, I know it's really late, and we had a long worship service, and it kind of got us a little behind, but would you just bear with me for 2 minutes? I'm just going to ask you for 2 minutes. I just want to share something from my heart. It kind of goes along with what Pastor Kennie taught on today, but the attack on the families and the attack on traditional marriage. This past week, you may have seen in the news that there was an Assembly of God church in the North Texas district that made an announcement through the preaching and online word and on their website that they were becoming fully LGBTQ inclusive. And what that means is that they were not only welcoming folks who are in that lifestyle to the church, but that they are allowing them to come on staff as pastors and starting to perform same-sex marriages. It's something that I didn't think I would ever see in an Assembly of God church, but it's something that happened. And the enemy is fierce in this area. So I want to make a public statement, both online and to our church, that as long as Jessica and I are your leadership here at First AG, we will always stand with the Assembly of God tenets of faith. We will always stand with the principles governing the Assemblies of God. And we will always stand with what the Bible says about what marriage is and that it's God's original institution. Now, that being said, I want to make it known that we welcome folks who are dealing with same-sex attraction. We welcome folks who are dealing with homosexuality in their life. We welcome them to come here, feel the presence of God, meet Jesus, and allow him to come in and offer change to their lives. We welcome them, and we'll love on them, and we'll hug them. But what this church has done is completely out of order, completely wrong. But one thing that I want to say, and this is where being a part of a denomination matters, because we're a part of the Assembly of God fellowship, but as a denomination, the Assemblies of God was able to come in into this situation and remove the pastor from credentialed ministry in the Assembly of God, remove the church as an Assembly of God church. Not only that, but listen, this is where it went one step further, is they set up the opportunity for those within that body of believers, which are a few thousand people, they set up the opportunity for them to come meet so that they could get them plugged into an Assembly of God church that held up the tenets of faith. So they moved and they did an amazing thing. And I'm grateful for that. So I just felt like I needed to make that statement today because it's been in the news, especially in Christian news. It's been in Christian news articles all week online and Facebook. And as an Assembly of God church, I wanted to address you in that way and just share with you that we as a church, First AG Inverness, will always, always stand on the biblical definition of marriage, which is one man, one woman, husband and wife. Amen? So grateful for that. But I want to pray you guys out. You guys are late getting to Golden Corral. I know that. So I'm going to pray for you. But next week, please come back. We're going to have our finale for this series. I'm going to be preaching on relationships, but not only relationships, but I'm going to be preaching on toxicity in relationships. And it has to do, listen, I know the last couple of weeks we've been talking about marriage a lot. And for a lot of you singles, divorced folks that are sitting here, that may be hard to hear. That may be hard to struggle with. But next week, we're moving into all relationships, toxicity in your relationship. And it can be a marriage relationship all the way down to friendships. So it pertains to everybody. So come out, be a part of that, and stand with me. And let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Father, I thank you for your instruction and your guidance and your word. Lord, I thank you for Pastor Kennie delivering that well-worked-out teaching on family today. Lord, I just pray that we would all maintain and see people through your eyes, Lord. That we would see our families through your eyes. That we would see our marriages through your eyes. Lord, that you would always be working on our hearts, Lord. And we make ourselves available to you. Father, I just pray that each of us in this room, that we would make ourselves available to you to complete the good work in us that you've started, Lord. Guide us and direct us. Help us to be more and more Christ-like in our everyday walk. Father, I pray over your church today that as they leave, that you would have your hand of protection on them. You would guide them, direct them, and return them again this Wednesday night or next Sunday in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. God bless you guys. Have a great, great Sunday today. We'll see you next time.